everybody. Welcome back to the Catholic Culture Podcast. Before we start today's episode, I would want to mention a couple of other projects that are not associated with our little podcast network, but are really worthwhile. I think they're doing good things. The first is Square Notes, the Sacred Music Podcast. This is something I started listening to, I don't know, maybe about a year ago, and when they were new, and since then they've only gotten more interesting. It's a really great mix of theology and history and practical things for church musicians and educators, and the spiritual aspects of sacred music. And they're just doing really great stuff. They've got great guests, including Cardinal Seurat in a couple of episodes, and also they had James McMillan, the great Scottish sacred music composer. And the other one, on a more serious, well, not a more serious topic, I suppose, but a more less happy topic, is Crisis, Clergy Abuse in the Catholic Church. This is a mini-series associated somehow with Catholic University, I think, that is dealing with, obviously, the abuse scandals in the church, kind of a thorough accounting of them. And it's not always easy to listen to, but it's very well done. It's done from an Orthodox place and from, I don't know, from a spiritually sound place, it seems. And it's also very, very highly produced for a Catholic podcast. It has the feel of like a radio documentary or something like that. And something on that level of production value is still fairly rare in our corner of the podcast world. So again, that's Square Notes, the Sacred Music Podcast, and Crisis, Clergy Abuse in the Catholic Church. Those aren't affiliated with us, but I just wanted to mention them because I think they're worth boosting. So I'll link to both of those in the show notes. Today's guest is a friend of ours in Pittsburgh. And by a friend of ours, I mean that we're in the mafia. Mike Aquilina is the host and writer of our own sister podcast, Way of the Fathers. He's the author of, I believe, over 60 books now, most of which came out this year. And he is a poet, lyricist, and songwriter, particularly collaborating on a recent hit blues album with the legendary singer, guitarist, and songwriter, Dion. Mike, welcome back to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me back, Tom. It's good to be here.
This is my second time seeing you in person, so to speak. The first time was actually in person last year, but it's always nice to catch up. So we're just going to be catching up on what you've been up to. Would you say this year has been more, less, or equally prolific as previous years of recent memory?
It's been a busy year, that's for sure, since the beginning. I expected it to be a little slack once we had the lockdown, because a number of my speaking engagements were canceled. That's usually my busy season,
right,
during Lent. They were canceled, sure enough, but there was a lot more demand for writing, that's for sure, because the church in the United States was kind of reinventing Lent, reinventing Holy Week, reinventing the Easter season, trying to explain to people how to celebrate in these times, how to observe the seasons properly. So I had a lot of writing to do anyway. It ended up being, I think, the busiest year of my adult life, even though I hardly left home at all.
How about that? How many books do you think you had out? I'm counting three, but could be more.
I don't know. I think three this year, yes. Yes, I think early this year I had a book out called Work, Play, Love, and that came out from Paraclete Press. And then this fall I had History's Queen come out from Ave Maria Press, and the collection of my poems, The Invention of Zero, came out from Serif Press. So yeah, three books this year.
Well, I guess it'll be four with the Catholic University volume, right?
Yeah, if that comes out this year. It's scheduled to come out during this publishing season. So that's in the series they have on the sayings of the Fathers of the Church. I think this will be the third volume in that series. It's I'm really honored to be in it. because the other contributors are authors I really admire. So that I think will be out soon too. And it's a collection of sayings from the Church Fathers on the Holy Mass. And I kind of walk through the Mass, just giving the Fathers observations on those parts of the Mass.
Do you comment on the readings at all, or is it just a straight anthology kind of thing?
In the beginning, I have a history that gives some of the development of the liturgy from century 1 through century 5, say. Once I get into the meat of the book, I let the Fathers do all the talking.
So I guess let's start with this this album with Dion, Blues with Friends. This is an album that had, you know, was a collaboration with all of these people who obviously respect and love Dion. Some of them have worked with him in the past. Jeff Beck, Joe Bonamassa, Paul Simon, Bruce Springsteen, Van Morrison, a lot of huge, huge names were collaborating on this album. And it was at the top of the blues chart, am I right?
Oh, yeah.
For quite a while. How long was it on there?
It's still on the charts now, actually. It's been on the charts for 14 weeks, always near the top. And I think we've spent 9 weeks in the number one position on the Billboard blues charts. We were also on the UK blues charts. We debuted at number one there. I haven't been following it, so I don't know where we are now. But our chart positions have been great all the way through. And it's as I said, it's only 14 weeks now.
That's amazing, though. So I'll say right off the bat, my knowledge of older pop, rock and roll, and blues is very selective. So I had never heard of Dion before I met you, honestly. But you know, going through in preparation for this interview, and we talked about him a little bit in our first conversation way back. I think it was episode 12 mm-hmm. of this podcast. Now we're in. I don't know what episode this will be, but it'll be closer to 100. Looking through information about him, kind of scrolling through a playlist of, you know, best of Dion. My experience was kind of like, oh, okay. Runaround Sue. I've definitely heard this. This sounds like I heard this in my childhood. I don't know where I would have heard it, but I've definitely heard it. A Teenager in Love. I've definitely heard that. Ruby Baby. Okay, I haven't heard his version, but I've heard Donald Fagen's version on the Nightfly album. And then, you know, oh, wow, he's on the cover of the Sgt. Pepper album. He's one of only two contemporary figures who were on the cover of that album, him and Bob Dylan. And Bob Dylan wrote the liner notes to this album. So I started getting an idea of this guy's stature.
He's the only artist, the only headliner who survived from The Day the Music Died, the Winter Dance Party tour, when Buddy Holly and the Big Bopper and Ritchie Valens died in the plane crash. He's the only one who lived to tell the tale.
Yeah. And he's a convert to Catholicism.
Yes.
So I guess I should ask you, as a lyricist, how did you feel to have Bob Dylan writing the liner notes for an album that you were involved with?
I was taken aback. I mean, that was amazing to me. You know, I grew up listening to Dylan. I was born in 1963, so he's someone I've always been aware of. I grew up in a kind of musical family. My brother Charlie played guitar in a band, so Dylan was always there and always a giant, really, from my infancy. So to have him writing the liner notes, and not only that, but praising the songs for their craft, was quite a rush for somebody from my generation.
Yeah, it's pretty impressive, and I read the liner notes, and it was very very complimentary indeed. I should also mention for people, if anybody wants to listen to an interview with Dion himself, I would recommend Patrick Coffin's interview. I'm glad he did it because he's clearly much more knowledgeable about this era and this scene in music than I am, and I thought he did a great job. So I'll link to that as well. He had a nice, really nice interview with Dion on his podcast. Let's go ahead and hear one of the songs from this recent album. I believe. Well, let's start with the song for Sam Cooke. here in America.
Audio yeah. Rolling. Yeah, this is a song called Here in America. It's a song for Sam Cooke. I travel with him in the South through Memphis, and great guy, beautiful gentleman. We travel the slam back in 1962. We play the places that were We traveled to slam back in 1962. We played the places that were home to me and you. We drove to Memphis, we rocked the set. We walked the streets at night and smoked a cigarette here in America. Here in America, there was so much I didn't know about the way that life could go. Here in America, down the block I saw the people stop and stare. You did your best to make a Yankee boy aware. I never thought about the color of your skin. I never worried about the hotel I was in. Here in America,
in America,
but the places I could stay, they all made you walk away. Here in America. You were the man who earned the glory and the fame, but cowards felt that they could call you any name. You were the star standing in the light that won you nothing on a city street at night. Here in America, here in America, you were told that we were free. This land is made. Here in America, you stayed more steady than a backbeat on a drum. You told me you believed the change was gonna come. You sang for freedom, but lived life free. I saw it in your smile and in your dignity. Here in America, singing the truth to set us free. Here in America, here in America, you were a star when you were standing on a stage. I look back on it, I feel a burning rage. You sang, you sent me, I sang, I wonder why. And I still wonder, you were way too young to die. Here in America, here in America. Hey Sam, I wish that you were near. I wish that you were here. Here in America, here in America, America, in America, here in America,
Well, I never thought I'd get a chance to sing that song. I wrote it like years ago. That's wild. And I put it on, I blew it up. It's a good story. No, it's true. It's a true story. You know? Sam Cooke took us to see James Brown in the Flames when James Brown, nobody even knew him. And he would, you know, we were traveling in the South and it was the kind of the opposite way around. He stood up for me in those situations where people had attitudes, you know, in a community that wasn't mine. He'd say, hey, the boy's with me. He was a big guy, a very beautiful guy. I miss him.
So perhaps you can tell me a little bit about Sam Cooke and kind of what his significance is, what he means to Dion, that he did this tribute.
Well, Sam Cooke was one of the giants of that generation in music. He died very young, and he was shot to death outside his hotel room. It was a difficult time, of course. We're talking about the time of Jim Crow, and Dion had grown up in the Bronx, and he was touring with Sam Cooke. They were the two headliners. There were many acts in the show. They were the two headliners, and they were touring the cities in the North and the South. And when they got to the Southern cities, Dion said he just had never experienced anything like that. He said there was there was racism in New York in the way people talked and the way people acted, but there wasn't the kind of separatism that he found in the South. He was really shocked that that Sam Cooke couldn't stay at the same hotel that the rest of the band stayed in, or even where the roadies stayed. He couldn't eat in the same restaurants. They had to go into the restaurant and then bring his lunch out to the bus so that he could eat by himself on the bus. He said that this kind of shocked him. Well, Dion had always told me that story, and I had it kind of in my mind. And then one day Dion called. He had a song, he said, and he'll usually call and he'll sing along with nonsense lyrics. And when he did this song, the lyric that he sang for all the choruses was, "Here in America, here in America." Well, he did this just as my daughter Grace and I were talking about Sam Cooke. My daughter's a huge fan of Sam Cooke. So we were talking about that. So I said to him, I said, "You know what this is about? This is about Sam Cooke. This is about your tour." And he was like, "I got to see that." So I did. I wrote it out in his voice because I'd heard him tell the story before. I wrote it out as the story of their travels through the South. And he loved it. And it's funny because he recorded a demo of it. And he was so shaken by doing it that he put it aside. And he didn't work on it anymore after the demo. And he didn't intend to include it on the album Blues with Friends, because it was too personal. And we got to the end of the production process for the album, and he said, "No, I got to put that song on there." And so he called Paul Simon, and he asked Paul Simon if he would sing it as a duet with him, and he agreed. He was on vacation in Hawaii, and so he rented a studio there, and he did his vocal parts and sent them in, and they were just stunning. Blew us all away, and so it was a really great great addition to the album. I think it's probably the one we've had the most feedback on, and probably the one that's had the most play online.
Interesting. Yeah, well, Paul Simon, there's another of the great lyricists. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he kind of conveys the love of for Sam Cooke, and also the frustration.
Yeah.
The frustration at seeing what happened to him, and the frustration of seeing life through his eyes, I guess.
What I love about Dion is that he is very positive. He's been working in the music industry for, well, 60 some years now, and he has seen a lot of progress. He's seen a lot of advancement. And so it does end, the song ends on a positive note in that he's saying to Sam Cooke, I wish you were here with me. I wish you were here to enjoy what I'm enjoying now, to see what I'm seeing now. And that's an acknowledgement of the progress that's been made since the early 1960s.
Sure. Well, that's unusual these days in itself, I suppose. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. Can you give me a sense of Dion's influence in music?
His influence. Wow. Well, when you start to line these guys up, especially the artists who've paid tribute to him, they cite him as either the major influence or one of their major influences. They include Bruce Springsteen, Bob Dylan, Van Morrison, all of these guys, John Lennon, who said that Dion really formed their technique as rock and roll singers. Wide variety of singers there, and all of them citing him as an influence. Bruce Springsteen just recently mentioned him in the pages of the Wall Street Journal when he was talking about his early influences. So yeah, Dion's a giant, you know. And when I was growing up, he was even more of a giant because he was an Italian American. Okay, he was part of the indicators that we had arrived, that we were no longer the new kids on the block, that we were finding our place in America. Mm-hmm. I always tease him. I said, you know, you were like Joe DiMaggio. You know, this was the signal that we were American. You know, we had made it. So I grew up in a place where he was very important. My sisters, who were teenagers when I was born, they were dancing to his music, of course. And my brother was playing his songs. So that when I did meet Dion, and I knew I was going to meet him, this was quite a while ago, I brought a 45 of Abraham, Martin, and John because I had one, and I got him to sign it for me.
To what extent do you collaborate on the music itself as well as the lyrics?
Well, it depends. Usually if I write a lyric that doesn't already have a melody, what he'll do is he'll call me and he'll say, I want you to sing it for me. So I'll either do a voice memo or I'll sing it into his voicemail or something. And I'll tell you, that is a humiliating thing to do because I am thinking, here is one of the first inductees in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, a man who has amazing control over his voice, who's influenced all of my heroes in rock and roll, and he's asking me to sing. I can barely carry a tune. Every now and then, I'll have a melody in mind when I do it. Almost never has he gone with my melody. The guy is a genius at interpreting a lyric and finding the melody that's right for it. So I'd say that the only song where I actually came up with the melody and the lyric was one of the Christmas songs that we'll be releasing a little bit later this year.
At the beginning of every episode, I always say that this podcast is a production of CatholicCulture.org, and that's because Catholic Culture is a much bigger apostolate than just our podcasts. We offer so many resources: Catholic news and commentary, resources for living the liturgical year, a massive and ever-growing library of Catholic reference material free of charge. Astonishingly, we end up reaching tens of millions of Catholics and potential converts every year, and part of that is because we allow others to reuse our material free of charge. It's widely used in social media, reprinted on other websites, used in television and radio programs. My own podcast is rebroadcast by a Catholic radio station in Texas, and we don't charge them anything to do that. Our articles reappear in print media, magazines, newspapers, parish bulletins. I've personally met priests who say that they use our material for catechesis and for inspiration, for homilies. And this is really an international thing because we get plenty of emails from priests in places like India and Africa who use our material for catechesis. Now, Catholic Culture is a nonprofit and we run almost entirely on donations. As you can imagine, every year there's sort of a question, okay, are we going to be able to keep going next year? Especially right now, we are struggling financially because our income was down about 25% during the summer of the pandemic, and we lost quite a lot of monthly pledges from people who had been hurt economically. And so it is time for our 2020 Fall Challenge campaign. Thankfully, a generous donor has offered a matching grant of $100,000, which means, well, it's self-explanatory, all of your gifts between now and December 8th, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, will be matched. If you'd like to help keep this and our other three podcasts going, please go to catholicculture.org/donate/audio. And if you can't donate, or even if you can, please also keep us in your prayers. We depend on those as much as on financial support. And as I've said many times, we pray for all of our listeners, donors, all of our users every day. Thank you, and God bless you. You told me that your favorite sometimes was the song on this album was Told You Once in August. I think that also is my favorite on the album. Now, who did he collaborate with on this one? John Hammond and Rory Block.
Yes.
On this one. Let's hear that.
I told you once in August, I told you once in May, told you once in August, I told you once in May. Well, don't say I never warned you, not child. Don't say you got no sense. I've been working hard for you, baby. I swing a hammer all day long. I'm working hard for you, baby. I swing a hammer all day long. Well, then I get home in the evening, I'll try and I find you do me wrong. Whiskey on your kiss. Oh, when you come home after midnight, damn, you got his whiskey on your kiss.
Whiskey on your kiss.
You can't get enough of cheating, no, baby. I had enough of this. I told you once in August, I told you once in May,
told you once in May.
Oh, well, I told you once in August, I told you once in May. Well, don't say it didn't warn you, not child. Don't say you got no say. I saw you come down from the mountain with moonlight on your back. I saw you come down from the mountain with moonlight on your back. I saw you breaking my heart now, baby. Not yet, give me another jacket. I wish you weren't so lovely, baby. I wish I didn't feel this pain. Oh, and I wish you weren't so lovely, baby. I wish I didn't feel this pain. I wish I never heard you singing. Summer rain.
look up to the sky. Day I met you in the ocean, now baby,
I look up, looking to, off the to the sky.
Well, I'm still looking up there, baby, looking up and wondering why. Still looking up there, and I aim up and wondering why. Wondering why, babe.
You helped to write this one as well, right? The lyrics on this one.
I did. I actually used some of his nonsense lyrics in it. I always try to mine those whenever I can, because I know he's comfortable singing those words. They've come out of his mouth naturally. And so for him, the words have to feel right in his mouth. For him, the words aren't a head thing. They have to feel right in his mouth. So I try to go with the words he's comfortable singing. And I Told You Once in August was actually one of the lines he sang in the demo for me. So I went from there to make it a song about betrayal, adultery, and the struggle to deal with this, which can drag on over months of suspicion and so forth. The song itself is just stunning. He was going for an Appalachian blues sound.
Right.
Which is a different sound altogether, and he played it on one of his cheap guitars, you know, and it gave it an amazingly spooky sound. Rory Block's work on it was just perfect, and John Hammond as well. I'm amazed by the way it turned out.
Yeah, Rory Block, was she one of the singers on that?
Mm-hmm. Yes, and she played guitar as well.
Okay, yeah, I'm not familiar with her work. Okay, so we'll play a couple more of these songs as we talk here. But for now, let's move on and talk a little bit about your book. Let's see, let me pull it up here. Is that visible?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. History's Queen, Exploring Mary's Pivotal Role from Age to Age. This is your most recently published patristics or church history book. And I read chapter 2 on the church fathers and Mary. I found it particularly interesting early in the chapter, the account of very early attacks on the status of Mary from non-Christians and from heretics. Can you give us a taste of that material?
Well, there's been a lot of research done in this area lately by not only Christian scholars but also Jewish scholars. You kind of get a sense a couple of times in the Gospels that both our Lord and our Lady took some taunting during the course of his earthly ministry because of the circumstances of his conception and birth. It does sound kind of unbelievable to someone who doesn't have faith. Well, what we find out from the documents of early Judaism, and also from some of the pagan documents from the same period, is that this was a point of attack upon Christians. That both the Jews and the pagans saw the conception of Jesus and his bodily resurrection as weak points. And so they went after those apologetically when they were attacking Christianity, questioning his origins, questioning his end. And there was even back and forth, we find, between the pagans and the Jews. One of the earliest extended arguments against Christianity is by a man named Celsus or Celsus. He wrote a book on the true, what he titled it on the true doctrine, okay, which was the standard paganism of his day, the philosophy of the day,
and like Neoplatonism.
He's writing it from the perspective of Greco-Roman religion and the basic, the fundamental principles of it. You know, and he's defending that against Christianity and Christianity's peculiar claims that the infinite entered the finite, for example, that God became man, and not only did he become man, but he became man in this backwater, the middle of nowhere, and he was born to a woman who wasn't of the leisured class, but spun cloth. And there are these fantastic claims about his conception and birth, and with some winks and nudges at that point, because both Chalcis and the early rabbis of the Talmud made charges against the honor of Our Lady, you know, saying that she had been an adulterer, a fornicator. And these get pretty explicit. So yes, that was something that the early Christians had to defend against from the very beginning. So not only do we detect hints of it in the Gospels, but immediately afterwards, you know, in around 70 AD, we have a book written in Egypt called The Ascension of Isaiah. And that book contains an account of our Lord's conception and birth, and it seems that the purpose of this account is to defend Our Lady's virginity. We find it coming up again in the letters of Ignatius of Antioch, who defends Our Lady's virginity, and then we find it in the Gospel of Mary, which appeared in the early years of the second century. So obviously, this is something that's very much on the minds of the early Christians. It's something that they feel the need to defend. And they're defending it against everyone, you know, because again, this seemed to be a point of weakness. If you don't have faith, these things do seem absurd.
So that point about these attacks being in the Talmud, that's not just like an anti-Semitic smear or something like that.
No.
It's interesting.
No, I mean, the book that's authoritative on the subject is called Jesus in the Talmud, and it's by Peter Schaefer, who was the executive director of the Jewish Museum in Berlin for many years. And he was the founder and director, I think he was the founder, in any event, he was the director of the Judaic Studies program at Princeton University. So we're not talking about fringe sources here. We're talking about very much the academic mainstream acknowledges this as a fact.
That's good. Yeah, sometimes I hear things from certain types online, and I'm not sure how much to credit.
No, Our Lady and Our Lord were Jews, you know, and I love the Jewish people for that reason, and every Christian is supposed to.
Right. What do you make of these kind of apocryphal documents? I mean, like, for example, you know, as you know, there's a debate about Pseudo-Dionysius. Like, is he a fraud? Is this just a literary approach that he uses this name? In other words, so for people who don't know, he's a very important theologian and philosopher, extremely influential on Aquinas and many other medieval thinkers. For a long time, people believed that he was the Saint Dionysius, the companion of Saint Paul in the New Testament, and it turned out that it was somebody else writing under that name. So when people you know, take a name or write in the voice of somebody else or claim to have a vision or something like that, and it turns out it has many edifying elements but isn't authentic, what do you make of that?
Well, often we can learn a lot even if we know that this is something inauthentic, that it's making claims that cannot be supported. Take the Gospel of Mary, all right? It's something that is done in the voice of Saint James, and it claims to have the authorship of Saint James. It's focused on the life, the early life of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and it tells us many things that we really don't find in other sources. We can't confirm those things. We can kind of confirm that they jibe with what we know from other documents, some of them. But in the main, it seems to be a work of imaginative fiction. What does that tell us? Well, it tells us a little bit about popular piety related to the Virgin Mary in the very early 100s. And that's a valuable insight that it gives us, because we know that that book was a best-selling book from the earliest years of the church. That's remarkable. And it tells us what attracted people, what appealed to them, what really rang the bell for Christians. And this has been done in every age since then, down to our own time. You know, the vampire novelist Anne Rice, not too long ago, wrote a multi-volume series of novels that told the story of the life of Christ. You know, you can picture someone from 2,000 years in the future kind of digging them out of the ground and wondering, hey, what's the deal with this? Are these authentic or not? Well, they can probably give people 2,000 years from now insight about, you know, the piety of people in the year 2005, 2006, 2007.
So with somebody like, I mean, we don't have to use him as a specific example, but somebody like Pseudo-Dionysius, is it basically on a case-by-case basis where people are making the judgment, was this person actually intending to deceive? Were they using the name as kind of like a literary device? Is there any kind of consensus about the meaning of this? I mean, I know with him, it's kind of fraught because people have their own theological agendas tied into what they say about the authorship, but
I think it's hard to make generalizations that would cover all cases, and not only that, but it's hard to make generalizations that would cover all interpretations of every case, you know, because there are genuine disputes about all of these things. Take Pseudo-Barnabas. You know, what it's usually called, the Epistle of Barnabas from the first century. And there's a lot of debate over whether this could be by the Barnabas we know from the Acts of the Apostles. It depends on the dating of it, of course. It depends on where it came from. Depends on what it says. And I really don't think that we can solve these disputes this side of the grave. It's just not going to come about. People will have their opinions, and I like to look at all of these things that bear the names of the apostles and their circle, and look to those and try to find out what they're telling me about the piety of the period, about the imagination, the religious imagination of that period. And we can learn a lot that way, I believe.
Well, so much for my attempt to start a feud with some other scholar on the podcast and thereby rocket to fame by having controversial discussions.
I'm not a scholar, so my opinion isn't worth much. I'm very much dependent on the work of scholars.
As we can tell from your backdrop there. I don't think you covered this in the book, but this is something I've always wondered about, the assumption. Mm-hmm. I guess I'm more convinced than ever that the assumption is actually specifically biblical.
Yes.
Although in a hidden kind of way. I think there's many reasons to believe that from Revelation, maybe even from wisdom literature, or at least certain things about Mary in wisdom literature. I think a lot more things about Mary are in the Bible, or at least in a prophetic way, than we realize. But in terms of the history of the doctrine, how far back can we trace that as being something explicitly believed or taught or celebrated?
Well, that's an interesting question, because for a long time, people always said it was late, and they would often say 4th century, because the earliest explicit reference that we have is from Epiphanius, where he talks about the various theories that are put forth about the end of Mary's life. Among them, the tradition that we honor now as the Assumption or Dormition of the Blessed Virgin Mary. This has actually been a flashpoint in scholarship very recently because of the work of Stephen Shoemaker. I guess about between 15 and 20 years ago, he brought out this book, and it's called Ancient Traditions of the Virgin Mary's Dormition and Assumption. And for the first time, he gathered together the material from Latin, Greek, Coptic, Syriac, and Ethiopic, all in one place with translations in the back. And what he says in the course of his book is that Marian studies has been dominated in the scholarly world by an anti-Catholic bias. There's a circular reasoning that we know that Marian piety arrives late in church history. Therefore, whenever we find a tradition, we date it late because we know that Marian piety is late in church history. So he goes through and he examines the material, and he says, actually, these things are pointing to a fairly early origin. Now, he's been backed up in this more recently by a man who's a giant in the field of New Testament studies, who's not a Catholic, but is a Protestant, and that's Richard Bauckham. Richard Bauckham, who wrote this book, The Fate of the Dead, Studies on the Jewish and Christian Apocalypses. And in it, he looks at the early accounts of Our Lady's Dormition and Assumption, and he's saying that these are actually from very early in church history. Again, here's a scholar who's not a Catholic, who's revered in his field, who is known for his critical scholarship. Now, if you mentioned earlier that the Assumption of Our Lady certainly appears, you know, as Catholics will say, in the book of Revelation, where she's revealed to be taken up into heaven, right? And crowned with the stars, with the moon at her feet, and clothed with the sun, very much appearing as a queen in heaven. And we know this is Mary because she's the mother of the male child who's born to deliver the nations, right? So we know that's Jesus. But Mary is shown typologically, and her assumption is shown typologically in the Old Testament as well. And the fathers were aware of this. So when you look at the Syriac hymns that are devoted to Our Lady by Ephraim and by Simon the Potter, you notice a pattern. You notice that Our Lady is often mentioned in conjunction with certain Old Testament figures: Moses, Elijah, and Enoch. Now, what do those three have in common? Moses, Elijah, and Enoch. According to tradition, all three of those were assumed into heaven at the end of their earthly days. There are early traditions, pre-Christian traditions, attesting to the Assumption of Moses. There's a document called the Assumption of Moses. Elijah, we get from the books of Kings. We see him ascending in the fiery chariot. And Enoch, there's a rich tradition of Enoch literature that has been used by both Jews in the ancient world and Christians even today in the Coptic world, in the Ethiopic world. So all of those figures were assumed into heaven, and they are all associated with Mary in the hymns to Mary that came out of the Syriac fathers. So yeah, there's a lot of evidence that shows Mary in this tradition of figures known for, among other things, chastity and purity, who were assumed into heaven at the end of their earthly days.
That's really amazing.
It is amazing.
It seems to happen a lot. I mean, I remember reading one of Peter Brown's books and seeing that purgatory, you know, was mentioned, or something like it was mentioned, much earlier than most people think.
Yeah.
How common was that interpretation of Revelation, the woman clothed with the sun, as referring to Mary, among the fathers? I remember reading, maybe it was Epiphanius. It was somebody who wrote a work on virginity, one of the earlier works on that subject. I can't remember the name of the author, but I think he touched on that passage, and I think he just said it meant the church. I remember. I don't know if he even touched on the possibility that it could be Mary, but I remember, you know, being kind of surprised by the absence of that, at the very least, in his work.
Yeah. In the Western Fathers, you find it hardly at all, and you won't find it in the early Fathers. You won't find a lot of commentary on the Book of Revelation at all, because some of the Fathers weren't at ease accepting it as canonical, for one thing. Eusebius says in one place it's canonical and in another place that it's not. So you could see he was of two minds in the course of his career. So in any event, they kind of looked at it as a mystical book. Even those fathers who accepted it looked at it as something that was to be hidden. It's for those who were ready to receive the teaching. And so it was kept secret, like the doctrine of the Eucharist. So yeah, you don't find the interpretation early on, but you don't find a whole lot on the book of Revelation early on. It's only with the fourth century that we find commentaries on the book of Revelation. Now, it's said that that Melito of Sardis wrote one in the second century. Unfortunately, it's lost to history, so maybe one day that will be found in the sands of Egypt, and we'll all be enlightened on how the very early church interpreted these passages.
Let's listen to a previous collaboration between you and Dion and Paul Simon, the single New York Is My Home.
Take me where the Hudson River not alone. New York is my home.
This is another one that is not quite a straightforward blues form tune. It is, it's got a kind of an interesting rhythm to the melody that allows you to do some kind of internal rhyme and fun things with the lyrics. So did the melody come first with that as well?
No, that was a hard song to do. And its origin was kind of funny. It was unusual because Dion called me and he said, "Hey, I want to write a song about New York. I love New York." He was, you know, he's born in New York, raised in New York, and he still has a place in New York City. So he said, "I want to do a song about New York. See what you can could come up with." So I worked on it, and I had in my mind, I'm not a New Yorker, so I had in my mind all of the things that Dion, the native New Yorker, had told me about New York. And one of his common lines is, "Hey, look, I'm a New Yorker. I'm skeptical. I'm cynical. I'm not going to believe anything you tell me." I've heard him use lines like that for a long time. So I wrote kind of a smart aleck song about New York City, where it talks about all the things you have to deal with, but hey, I love it anyway. So I sent it to him, and he calls me, and he said, "I hate this." He said, "You don't get it. You don't get New York, and you're not going to get it because you're not a New Yorker. So you know what? I'm going to do this one with Scott Kempner." So I said, "Yay, Scott would be great." Just because Scott is from the Dictators. Scott is from New York. You know, he gets New York. So I said, "That's good." So he calls Scott, and he has Scott do something. And Scott wrote a good Scott Kempner song, which was kind of edgy and angsty. And he sends it to Dion. And then Dion realized he wasn't communicating it because he didn't want edgy and angsty, and he didn't want smart aleck. And then he did something interesting that really shows his particular genius, in my opinion. He put the two versions, Scott's and mine, side by side, and he took out the lines that he liked from both of them. And then he just put all the lines together on the screen. And he rearranged them, and he interspersed lines of his own, and he made it this really touching love song to the city. And that's something that was not evident in either Scott's song, which was edgy, angsty, and mine, which was, you know, smart aleck. He made something really beautiful out of it, played it for Paul Simon, who pronounced it sublime and said he wanted to sing on it. And then they made the recording, and it was used in one of those television series with Alan Alda, and it was used by Ralph Lauren for his 50th anniversary catwalk. So it's gotten a bit of play. It's gotten some legs.
Yeah, you know, and the melody kind of has a mix of those different moods to it as well, I would say. I mean, starts out a little bit more gritty and bluesy,
yeah,
and becomes a little sweeter as it goes on,
yeah.
I think. Here's another early church question that's not about Mary. What is the deal with this agape meal thing I keep hearing about? I still haven't gotten a handle on that. It's one of these things that was apparently very typical of early Christians and apparently has completely disappeared today.
Yes.
As far as I know. So what is that? Why don't we have it anymore? What's its relation to the Eucharist, if any? What's going on here?
Well, if you dig into the literature, you'll find a lot of different reconstructions and a lot of different theories about what it was and why it went away. So I'm just going to give you my take on it. If you read 1 Corinthians chapters 10 and 11, you get this sense that the Eucharist was part of a full meal. And it was intended to be a solemn banquet in the style of the Jewish Sabbath meal, or the meals for the holy days, right? Like the Passover Seder. So you get this sense of solemnity there. Now, I don't think that transferred so easily into the Greco-Roman world. I think that the pagans who were newly introduced to the Judeo-Christian tradition, they didn't get it, okay? Because they had traditions of banquets where you got drunk, okay? And where you were respected for your social class, and where maybe you ate too much, and you really kind of lived it up in a worldly way. There's plenty of evidence in that of that in 1 Corinthians 11. You also get that sense from Romans and Galatians, Paul's letters to the Romans and to the Galatians, that there's trouble at dinner time with Christians. The Jews want to exclude the Gentiles, right? And people are excluding others by social class or ethnic origin or whatever. It's just not a happy time. So I think that gradually the church, without much discussion, it seems, just made the conclusion that the solemn banquet wasn't going to work in the Greco-Roman context. That the meal context just should fall away, and we should stick to the elements that we find in the narrative of institution in the Gospels, and those are bread and wine, and that's what we have today. So yeah, I think that the Eucharist, as we see it in St. Paul's letters, was part of a fuller meal, but I think it just didn't work. The pagans didn't get it, and they couldn't make that adjustment.
Wow, that's really interesting. Well, they seem to have the early Christians seem to have a number of interesting traditions and involving meals that I can't remember the details. I remember Peter Brown talking about this refrigerium thing. Was that involved with the it was a meal they would go and eat at the tombs of the dead, something like that?
Right, and they would pour wine or sometimes even put food down into a hole that went into the tomb. They're, in a sense, sharing the banquet with their dead. And so what we find is that Saint Monica wondered about this, because that was done in North Africa when she lived there. Right. And then she moved to Milan, and it wasn't done there. And as a matter of fact, Ambrose kind of frowned on the practice and was discouraging it locally. She gets the advice, you know, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. When in Milan, she didn't practice those things that she had practiced in North Africa. So this was something that was done. It was a custom.
Was it a syncretistic thing, or was it a genuinely, like, they weren't actually trying to feed their dead relatives? It wasn't like an ancestor worship thing. Or
no, I think it was considered to be symbolic. That we're sharing this meal with someone we know to be spiritually present, okay? Acknowledging the immortality of the soul. I don't think most people believed that they were actually sharing food and wine with their dead. It was a holdover from earlier Greco-Roman religion. That's for sure. It was done earlier, and I don't know what those people believed, whether they believed they were actually refreshing the dead or not.
So you had a collection of poems out this year.
Yes.
From Serif Press. The Invention of Zero, an accumulation of poems by Mike Aquilina. So accumulation seems appropriate because it seems that these came out over a wide span of time, much like Jane Greer's recent collection.
Yes.
This includes a previous collection. So is this your complete collected published poems or what?
It's pretty close. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it very much reflects your personality and your writing style and your sense of humor, and your interests as a nonfiction writer to a large extent in the church fathers and things like that. Do you have any favorite that you might like to read?
Business and Memory. That actually is one of my very early poems, and it was written for my wife. It was one of my first to be published in a national magazine. You are city traffic in my day, my mind, you know, a one-way street. At 9 o'clock, you're 15 feet through intersections blocking way for what I was about to say. This boardroom needs a traffic cop to press you on. Let's move it, doll. To blow his whistle, waving all my thoughts of business to the top of midday hills. Again, they stop for flashing lights and tracks and trains of thought. A siren blares and wanes. Then, speeding across the passing lanes, come you. You wink at work, and then it's back. Sweet gridlock once again.
So that was one of your earliest pieces, you said?
The earliest to be published, anyway, yes. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the poem on the next page, Toward a Metaphysics of My Son.
Yeah.
Okay. Even for your age, you're small. I wonder where you fit it all. Substance, essence, person, form. I wonder how you keep it warm. You toddle, wobbling all your ends. From here, I smell your accidents. You call no category home. You're in the essay, not the poem.
Was this also an early poem?
Yes, it was. I had been reading Gilson and Maritain and trying to deal with my 2-year-old son, and this is what comes of that.
That's great. Can you read Terms and Conditions?
Yes.
Was that the title of your previous collection, if I remember correctly?
Yes, yes it was. Yeah. This was the title poem. If you take out any term, the others vanish. Our T and C's are freedom, love, and hell. This is, I think, the thought we'd like to banish. It's true in Portuguese and even Spanish. It's true in any place you choose to dwell. If you take out any term, the others vanish. Drop hell. The world goes beige, or maybe tannish. Love dies unless it makes you feel unwell. This is, I think, a thought we'd like to banish. Forsaking love, the boy becomes more mannish, they say. It's after Eve that Adam fell. But take out any term, the others vanish. When trendy authors go dystopianish, and liberty no longer rings their bell, they type the kind of thoughts we'd rather banish. We're restless, and we'd really rather plan a shuffling of the terms that cast our spell. But if you take out any term, the others vanish. This is, I think, the thought we'd like to banish.
I feel like I've encountered that form before. Is that a common form?
It is. It's a villanelle. There are famous ones by Elizabeth Bishop and Theodore Retke. Theodore Retke's poem "The Waking," which I think is his most famous, is a villanelle.
Can you explain that form?
Well, you have two lines that repeat throughout, okay, and they alternate. In the different verses, and then at the end, you bring all of them together. It's a difficult form to write in because it's hard enough to write one line that bears repeating, but for a villanelle, you need to write two lines that bear repeating. So it's a tough one. Some people get very good at it.
We have to hear at least one of your patristic poems. So on page 7, let's hear Callistus.
Oh, Callistus, yes. Okay. This is about one of the early popes. Tertullian tore his dalmatic. Hippolytus had a cow. Both became schismatic when Callistus stood the prow. He had a heart for sinners, for concubines and such. His patience with beginners, they found a bit too much. They fled from the forgiving, the laxity and taints. But there's hope for all us living, if all three died as saints.
So you did an episode on Hippolytus not too long ago.
I did.
On Way of the Fathers. Tertullian, obviously, as you mentioned in the poem, and you did him even more recently, I guess. He was a rigorist of a kind, and became schismatic. Callistus, I guess it's pretty much all explained in the poem without a lot of historical details, but Yeah, that's a fun piece. You have, by the time this episode is released, you will have done a full year of episodes of Way of the Fathers, and you will have hit at least the 25, probably the 26 episode mark by the time this comes out. So I have to congratulate you on that, and thank you for your work.
Well, I had a good teacher. Thomas Mieris taught me how to set up my equipment and put me through the motions on all those early episodes so that I could think as a speaker instead of as a writer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's our most popular podcast, so
I've enjoyed it. I've really enjoyed it. It forces me to focus on the fathers as men, in ways I had not before, you know, and I really do feel like I'm getting to know them in ways just I'd never knew them before. So that's I'm grateful great. For the opportunity. I love telling stories, and they have great stories associated with all of them, really.
Do you have a favorite episode you've done so far?
Boy, some surprising episodes. I think I'm most fond of the one on Minucius Felix, of all people, this almost unknown father about whom we know almost nothing. But the reason I like that one so much is because of the feedback I got from people who had never heard of Minucius Felix, but then got into the text and enjoyed it so much. Because it's a novel. It's a work of a fictionalized memoir where he's recalling an episode in his life, and it's so vivid. And he includes all these little ordinary details like the boys who were skipping stones at the bay there in Ostia. Yeah. So it's a very interesting and unusual document from early Christianity. It's a very interesting look at that world that we don't get in the other fathers.
I've skimmed that, the Octavius, right?
Yes.
I've skimmed that, and I read the opening parts that you're describing, where it's basically a dialogue, but it's framed with this he and his friends walking along the seashore.
Yes.
Yeah, it feels so contemporary and its details. It's amazing.
It's three lawyers during a holiday, spending their vacation at a resort, and it's beautiful because it is so ordinary, and I think that one took a lot of listeners by surprise, and I got so much feedback on it that it just surprised me. That may be my favorite.
That's great. Do you have one that you're particularly looking forward to? I mean, we're gonna be covering the entirety of patristic history here, so
all of them. I've really enjoyed doing every single one. Because I came away from each one feeling that I had just spent a week walking with this giant, and listening to him and getting into his thought and trying to understand his motives. It's been a great adventure so far, and I'm looking forward to all the ones that are still to come.
That's great. Well, I've definitely been enjoying listening to those as well.
You have to clean them up.
Right. Can we hear one more poem? Can we hear To Be or Not on page 68?
68.
This might be my favorite one.
It's very short. I toil and spin to seem to have a heart half worth your love. To seem is twice the art. I fly from final chance to final chance. A cinder in the wind would seem to dance, but shatters should the wind hold back a breath. For you to leave me, love, would be my death.
I like that line about from final chance to final chance. What does that mean to you?
Oh, just the mercies we receive from the people who live with us. And I'm thinking in particular of my wife, who puts up with, with my moods and my frustrations and all of those things, and maybe gives me another chance after the last one that she really wanted to deal with. So it's kind of counting the mercies upon mercies that we receive when we live with a saint, as I do. Mm.
Let's listen to one more song from Dion. This is the final track on the Blues with Friends album, I believe, Hymn to Him. This is not a new song. He had recorded this before, but he seems to have changed it from major to minor, as far as I can tell, in this recent version. Let's go ahead and listen to that.
Do you walk in the shadows? Are your dreams swept with fear? Does your heart fill with sadness with the night drawing near? Do you yearn for the moment when you'll be safe and warm? Do you search for the shelter from life's oncoming storms? Come to Him through the darkness, come to Him through the rain. Walk with Him from misfortune, walk with Him from the pain. He's the light of salvation, He's the head that's never bowed. He's the first step of wisdom, He's the sun through the clouds. Walk with Him. If the winds of disaster have blown hard through your night, and the dreams you have cherished can't begin to take flight, take His hand through the sunlight. Lift your head high above, let your blood flow forever with the warmth of His love. Come to Him through the darkness, come to Him through the rain. Walk with Him from misfortune, walk with Him from the pain. He's the light of salvation, never bound. He's the first step of wisdom, He's the sun through the clouds. Walk with Him, blend your life with His blessings, drink the wine of tomorrow. Yesterday must be banished with the seeds of your sorrow. Your heart filled with sadness with the night drawing near. Do you yearn for the moment when you'll be safe and warm? Do you search for the shelter from life's oncoming storms? Come to Him through the darkness, come to Him through the rain. Walk with Him from the pain. He's the light of salvation, He's the head that's never bowed. He's the first step of wisdom, He's the sun through the clouds. Walk.
Come to Him.
did not work on the lyrics to this one, right?
No, I didn't. No. That came out when I was in high school.
Right. Is there anything you can tell us about it anyway?
Well, it's a song that he wrote to our Lord. And he was never happy with the way it turned out when it was recorded. So he wanted to do it again and do it right for our Lord. So he asked Patti Shalfa, who's Bruce Springsteen's wife, to sing with him on it. And she really went all out. And she recorded many vocal parts. And while she was working on it, her husband came into the studio and provided what Dion calls gravitas guitar that he could include on the recording as well. So he was very happy with the way it turned out on the album. And it's a fitting closer to the album, I think, because the album's Blues with Friends, and it ends with Dion's best friend, who's Jesus. It's also my wife's favorite song on the album, and it's one of only two that her husband did not write.
Dion did some gospel stuff. I think that was when the first one was recorded.
Yeah.
It's interesting. So he was, I guess, a born again Christian for a long time before becoming a Catholic. He was kind of raised Catholic, then went astray, born again Christian. Then after a decade or two, became a Catholic. Is that what happened?
Yeah. He was a heroin addict for 14 years. He's lucky he's alive. But he sobered up in the late 1960s. You know, got off drugs, got off booze, and literally met Jesus. You know, he was out jogging one day, and he said he suddenly was just jogging into this bright light, and he knew that the light was Jesus. You know, from that time, he's never desired a drug or desired a drink. You can visit him at his house. You know, he'll pick up a bottle of wine and pour you a drink. He doesn't care. You know, I mean, it doesn't affect him. He doesn't desire it. But he kind of wandered in the Protestant world for a while. You know, he recorded gospel music, and he would go from one church to another on these tours, large mega churches. And he won all the awards, Dove Award, all that kind of thing, for his music, his gospel music. And he was troubled by the differences that he saw in Protestant congregations. So he asked his own pastor, "Can you help me make sense of this? Why do we seem to disagree on everything? I go to one church, it does things this way, another church does things that way." And his pastor said to him, "Dion, listen, in essentials unity, in doubtful matters liberty, in all things charity." And Dion said, "Wait, I want to write that down." He always carries a notebook. So he takes out his notebook and he says, "Say that again." And he says it again. And at the end of it, he says, "That's St. Augustine." And Dion said, "Who's Augustine?" And he said, "Oh, he's one of the early Christian authors. You have to read him." So Dion went to Barnes & Noble and said, "I want to read something by Augustine." And he bought some books and he's reading them. And he's loving them. He loved the Confessions. But he said, "This doesn't look like my church. This looks like the Catholic church from my childhood." You know, because there it is. You know, it's about the Eucharist. It's about the hierarchy. It's about all of these things that he knew when he was a Catholic. And so he was still struggling with this. And he was watching EWTN one day, or he was channel surfing, and he landed on EWTN. And it was Marcus Grody's program, The Journey Home, and John Haas was the guest. John Haas had been an Anglican priest, and John Haas said the problem for him came down to authority. Who has the final say? Who gets to say who's right? And that was what kind of made John Haas become a Catholic. And Dion said to the television, "That's it. That's it exactly." And he knew he had to go home at that point, and so he actually went home. He got on a plane and went to the Bronx and went to Our Lady of Mount Carmel Church in the Bronx's Little Italy, and he went to confession. And at the end of it, the priest said, "Dion, stand up, come outside." And he gave him a big hug and welcomed him home.
That's amazing.
It is.
Another patristic victory there.
Yes, St. Augustine for the win.
You know, I think I've been to that church. Is it the one that's right in the Little Italy in the Bronx, like the Arthur Avenue or whatever it is?
That sounds right. That's the neighborhood.
Yeah, I think I went there. I went there on the Feast of St. Joseph last year. To the real, it's like the real Little Italy in the Bronx.
Right.
So there's the one in Manhattan is much less authentic than it was in the past, much smaller. The one in the Bronx is amazing because it feels like a real neighborhood and there's real Italians walking around.
Yes.
And it's great. And I went to Mass. I guess it must have been Our Lady of Mount Carmel there that I went to Mass at.
Well, yeah.
And they had this like blessed bread that they were giving out afterwards and. Yeah, pretty cool. There we go.
It is cool.
Oh, Mike, it's been a pleasure talking to you as always. Thank you so much for coming on the show.